Hi, my name's Jordan, and in this video I'll be sharing with you some of my tips on how to successfully raise up a queen ant, with the end goal of establishing an ant colony by bringing rise to the queen's first generation of worker ants. So the first obvious thing you'll need to get started is a queen ant. The queen is vital for the growth of the colony. Without her, no eggs will be laid and therefore no new generation of worker ants will emerge. If you haven't yet obtained a queen ant, in my previous tutorial I covered how to catch one, so go back and watch that video if you need some tips on finding queens. Once you've got hold of a queen, you'll then need to create a home for her. In the wild, most queens will construct a small chamber for themselves, underground or within a fallen tree. The chamber they form will be the space in which they will lay their eggs and spend the next few weeks and months tending to them, until eventually they eclose into worker ants. This period is known as the founding stage of an ant colony's development. So when creating an artificial home for a queen, it's best to try and emulate these natural conditions. I find great success raising queens within a small test tube setup. In this setup, the queen is confined to this small space here towards the top of the tube, with the remainder of the tube being used as a water reservoir. So she's able to drink from there, and it also creates some humidity within the setup. From above, you can see the resemblance to the wild queen's chamber. So in order to set this up, first fill up a test tube with fresh water, so it's about 3/4 of the way full. Then you want to block the water off with a cotton ball. Here I'm using a cotton bud to push the cotton ball through the tube. That way, if you push the cotton in a bit too far, you can absorb up any excess water that leaks through. Now the tube is ready for the queen. So gently get her into the tube, and once she's in there, just seal the end off with another bit of cotton. You want the seal to be tight enough to prevent the queen from being able to squeeze through, but not so tight as to prevent a little airflow. So if you're really having to force the cotton through the tube, it's probably too tight a fit. Perhaps tear the cotton in two and then use one of the halves to seal the tube instead. And that's essentially the setup. It's very simple and quite effective. You can even put a bit of sand or soil in there as well. Then the queen can dig and rearrange the space more to her liking, as she would in the wild. Just make sure you sterilize the sand or soil first. You can do this by either baking or boiling it. Now, if you don't have any test tubes or the equivalent of one, I really recommend buying some. They're usually pretty cheap. I went on Amazon a few years ago and bought about 100 tubes for like $15 or so. Otherwise, you can just use a small container with a couple of moistened cotton balls placed inside for hydration and humidity. Just make sure the container isn't airtight. So what you can do is bore a small hole into the container and then just stuff those holes with a bit of cotton ball to allow for a bit of airflow while containing the queen as well. This is a perfectly suitable setup, but the downside is you'll have to continually make sure the cotton remains moist, as your queen must have a constant access to water. So it requires a bit more work on your part, and the regular checking up on the queen could also potentially stress her out as well. So a test tube is a preferable setup. Regardless of what setup you choose to go with, remember that this is going to be the queen's home for some time. So when preparing it, make sure all your equipment is sterile and your hands have been thoroughly cleaned beforehand with hot soapy water. This will help reduce the chance of harmful mold and bacteria taking over your setup and threatening the health of your queen. Something you'll need to determine is whether the queen you have is semi or fully claustral. Typically, you can differentiate the two by the size of their bodies. Fully claustral queens tend to have a larger thorax and gaster section, but a smaller head when compared to semi-claustral queens. If you've identified what species of queen you have, a quick bit of research on that species will usually reveal whether they're semi or fully claustral or not. Fully claustral queens are able to sustain themselves on water alone until their workers emerge. Achieving this long period of fasting by utilizing fat reserves and metabolizing their now useless wing muscles. So feeding these queens is unnecessary. However, I find providing them with a source of sugary food early on to be quite beneficial for their development. So after I've housed my queens, I'll offer them a tiny drop of honey. I only put the very slightest amount into the setup. Any food that's left lying around will promote mold growth. So if you happen to place in more food than the queen is able to consume, make sure you clean it out as soon as possible. Semiclostral species, queens of the genus Mimesia, Rhytida panera, and Odontomachus, for example, lack the ability to fast during the founding process and must leave their egg-laying chambers to hunt for food in order to nourish both themselves and their growing larvae as well. So unlike fully clostral species, you'll need to feed them and provide a space in which they can forage for this food. What you can do is place the test tube or container you've got them set up in and put it inside a container like so, and this space will be used as their foraging area. This outer container can be any size you wish, and some protein and sugary-rich foods should be provided for the queen within. Just make sure the container is escape-proof and isn't airtight. Some species of ants are polygamous, meaning they often found their colonies with multiple queens present. These include many species within the genera Phidolae, Solenopsis, and Monomorium. I would advise against attempting to house two or more queens together, however. Even species known to be polygamous can often turn against one another, resulting in one or even all of the queens dying. It may be tempting to put a bunch of queens together and create a super colony, but it's often safest just to keep the queens on their own. Once you've got your queen appropriately housed, you'll want to cover the setup from any light and place it somewhere free from any vibrations. You'll also want to pick a place in which stays at a consistent temperature, so avoid placing the setup within an air-conditioned room, as rapid changes in temperature can be harmful to the queen. Pick a place in which the temperature doesn't fluctuate too much and where it will stay relatively warm, ideally 20 degrees Celsius or above. It's important to keep the queen relaxed and comfortable within her environment. A queen that's disturbed too often may become stressed and discontinue laying eggs and even consume the eggs she's laid, so avoid troubling her as much as possible. I like to put my queens in a box, somewhere quiet, and only check up on them once every few weeks or so. Once the queen has settled into her home, she should begin to lay her first batch of eggs. Sometimes they'll begin laying almost immediately, but usually it takes a week or two. If it's been over a month and the queen still hasn't laid any eggs, it could mean a few things. The queen may potentially be infertile, or she could be stressed and uncomfortable within her living space. Or if you live in a temperate region, she might just be waiting for warmer weather before getting her colony underway. Sometimes mold can inevitably start to form within your setup, and you may need to move the queen elsewhere in order to keep her healthy. Here's a test tube setup which isn't looking too great. What I do in this situation is prepare a fresh tube and just tape it to the end of the old one. Notice I don't tape it all the way around, so as to leave just a little gap for air to get in. Next, what you want to do is expose the old tube to light while covering up the fresh tube. The queen will be distressed by the light and will look to relocate to the darkened tube. I like to use natural, indirect light in order to influence the move, but you can use artificial lighting as well. Just make sure the tube isn't positioned too close to the light source, as the radiating heat could potentially cause flooding within the tube. The moving process may start straight away, or may take a few days or even weeks if the queen is really stubborn. It's important to remain patient though, and allow the queen to move in her own time. Once the queen is relocated, just make sure she has transported all of her brood across before detaching the old tube. Occasionally, despite all of your efforts in accommodating for your queen, she can unexpectedly die, without any real explanation as to why. Try not to be discouraged by this, and just focus on other queens you may have caught or catching another queen. Ant-keeping often requires patience. It can sometimes take a long time for the first generation of workers to finally arrive. If you're not the patient type, however, you can speed up the process by heating your colonies. Here I've got a heating mat set up. I've positioned the tube so the entrance is just touching the edge of the heat source. This establishes a temperature gradient within the tube and allows the queen to position herself and her brood at the most preferable level of heat. You can also judge if the queen is either accepting of the heat or not by where she has positioned herself within the tube. If she's positioned herself right up against the end of the tube, closest to the heat sources she can possibly get, then you know that she's quite happy with the heat, and you can shift her further towards the heat source. If she's positioned herself well away from the heat source, then you want to shift the setup further away from the heat source. It's better if the queen is below her ideal temperature than over it, so start with the setup fairly far away from the heat source and only gradually move it closer, carefully observing the queen as you go. If you're heating a container-style setup, just be wary that the moisture within the cotton balls will evaporate even faster within the presence of the heat, and so you'll need to add in water more frequently. If everything goes well, between 1 to 3 months later, depending on temperature conditions, the first generation of workers will finally emerge. For me, this is the most exciting time as an ant keeper. After watching the queen's progress from laying and tending to her eggs and feeding the larvae and then waiting patiently for them to close, it's just so satisfying seeing all the queen's hard work finally pay off. And then seeing the queen get a much needed break as the newly emerged workers begin taking over her previous duties, leaving her to just relax and lay more eggs for the next generation. So that's it for this video. I hope you found it somewhat helpful. My next video will be on what to do after the first generation of workers have arrived, covering what to feed the colony and effective ways in which to house them. So look forward to that, and thanks for watching.